In this video, I'm going to talk all about controlling varroa without using chemical treatments. It's often the default answer of many beekeepers all around the world when they have a varroa problem to go to the chemical arsenal and put those compounds in their hives to try to control varroa. But the whole premise behind varroa integrated pest management is that you do a lot of non-chemical control options as long as possible to keep those varroa populations as low as possible so that you don't have to intercede with chemical treatments frequently. So this video is very important because I'm going to be discussing with you all of those non-chemical ways to keep those varroa populations low as possible as long as possible. Again, integrated pest management does not eliminate the need for chemical treatments in honeybee colonies. On the other hand, when done well, it postpones or reduces the frequency that you will have to put chemicals in colonies to control varroa. So if you think about the chemical treatment pyramid, at the very bottom of that pyramid would be prevention. So prevention is not really a varroa control, but it's something you would do in advance of trying to control varroa. And just like the name implies, prevention, you are trying to prevent the presence of varroa in your hive or the movement of varroa to other areas. So let's think about that in two different ways. From a prevention standpoint, it is possible in some areas around the world to control varroa simply by starting colonies without varroa. There are plenty of regions around the world where varroa hasn't yet moved. So for example, if you are keeping bees in those areas, a great strategy is not moving bees into those areas from areas where varroa are present. Another option that might be possible wherever you live is that you can purchase varroa-free bees to start your apiary. And again, in many places around the world, that's not possible because varroa is present in so many different areas. But if you happen to be keeping bees in an area where varroa is not yet present, it's very possible to prevent the movement of varroa into your area. Now, the flip side of that prevention coin is that we also, as beekeepers, have an obligation to do things in our apiary to prevent the movement of varroa out of those apiaries. And so I'll give you four examples. In the first example, you need to do things to reduce drifting and robbing behavior. If you think about it, when a colony is weakened to varroa, it becomes vulnerable to other colonies in the apiary who send their bees to those colonies to rob out the resources. And that's a great way for varroa from the sick colony to jump onto the bees from the healthy colonies and fly back to those healthy colonies. So that's accomplished both through robbing, when bees are stealing resources, or drifting, where bees from heavily varroa parasitized colonies are moving into neighboring colonies because they're going back to the wrong hive. Another thing that really helps prevent the movement of varroa from your apiaries out is swarm control. Simply limiting swarms in your hives from happening, because when you are losing swarms to the environment, you are basically putting unmonitored colonies in the environment, and these colonies serve as a reservoir for varroa to reinfest your hives. So swarm control is one way to reduce that feral varroa population that's ready to reinfest your hives. Another good way is through the regulation of movement, just simply keeping bees from moving in and out of areas. For example, you don't want to move bees from varroa present areas into varroa not present areas, because then you're facilitating the spread of varroa. So if you think about those four ways, reducing drifting, reducing robbing, swarm control, and movement regulation, these are ways to limit the presence of varroa in the environment and the movement of varroa from your apiary. So prevention is really the foundation upon which the IPM pyramid is built. And so as we move into that pyramid, the very first step then of that pyramid would be cultural control methods. Now, cultural control methods are methods aimed at changing the hive environment to make it difficult for varroa to survive or reproduce. So I'll give you three primary examples. In the first of those examples, we have brood interruption. So the idea behind brood interruption is very, very, very simple. Varroa need honeybee brood on which to feed and reproduce. So if you can create periods of broodlessness in your hives, then you can tax the varroa population. So beekeepers around the world might accomplish this by simply removing all the frames of brood from a hive at one time and installing back in frames of foundation or frames of drawn comb, essentially asking bees to start over. And when you remove those frames of brood, you are taking out with you those varroa. You can freeze those frames of brood, kill a lot of varroa in those frames, and then return those frames back to the nest for use in the future. A lot of times as well, people will cage the queen for up to 28 days. This creates a significant gap in brood production in the hive, and when there's no brood, they may layer on top of this cultural control practice a chemical control of some sort, because varroa are far more vulnerable to chemical treatment when there's no brood in the nest. So the idea of brood interruption is having no brood in the nest, which allows you then to do something else to control the varroa on the adult bees. A second option within this cultural control system is apiary separation. Remember, we worry a little bit about varroa moving between apiaries. You've got this apiary here, you're treating it, you're on top of it, you're controlling the varroa, it's no problem at all. But maybe there's an apiary that's nearby where those things aren't happening. Maybe it's your apiary, maybe it's the apiary of another beekeeper. And as such, varroa are just coming in from the outside on bees, or your bees are going in to the outside and getting those varroa. So keeping apiaries separated appropriately so there's minimized drift and minimized robbing between those apiaries so that you've got just a varroa population in your own apiary to control. Now, a subcategory under cultural control, the third thing that I'm going to talk about under cultural control, is really kind of genetics and breeding. You could argue that genetics and breeding represents its own category of varroa control in this integrated pest management period, but I'm going to put it under cultural control to make it easier to think about. Because in reality, through genetics and breeding, you are trying to create a situation in the hive where varroa are finding it difficult to survive and reproduce. That's what genetics and breeding does. So what do I mean by genetics and breeding? Honeybees are like livestock in many ways in the fact that you can breed them to have certain traits that confer varroa resistance or tolerance are things that you can select for. So through focused breeding programs, you can control the resistance or the resistance traits that are displayed by a particular honeybee. For example, here in the U.S., we have several different stocks of honeybees that have been bred for resistance. For a good example is the hygienic trait. The hygienic trait is the trait expressed by worker bees where the worker bee can detect under a capping of a brood cell that an individual developing bee is being parasitized by a varroa. So the worker outside of that cell can detect inside of that cell that there is a varroa presence, and she can uncap that cell and abort the developing honeybee as well as get rid of that varroa. So we call that behavior hygienic behavior. So bees that have heightened hygienic expression tend to have lower varroa populations, and you can select for this trait. There are other traits such as grooming behavior, where bees will groom off of themselves varroa or groom off of other bees varroa. There's specialty versions of this particular stock of bees, for example, ankle biter bees, where the bees will literally bite the varroa, tear them to pieces, and throw out the carcasses outside of the nest. So hygienic behavior, grooming behavior. There are other traits in the honeybee world that are being selected for. And again, here in the U.S., there are multiple stocks that express this. Minnesota hygienic queens obviously have been selected for resistance via the hygienic behavior. There's the Purdue University ankle biters, which have obviously been selected for resistance via this grooming behavior. There are other stocks such as the pole line or the Russian honeybee. Both of these breeds have been produced by the USDA ARS laboratory in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And there's even the New World Carniolan honeybee that's selected for many different varroa traits. That's just inside of the U.S., the buckfast bee and others. Outside of the U.S., others are looking at breeding bees for resistance to varroa, primarily through hygienic behavior. So breeding and genetics all kind of collectively fall under this cultural control where when it's happening in a hive, varroa populations are reduced. And I recommend to every beekeeper to use a resistant stock or a stock that's been selected for these traits. As we move up the IPM treatment pyramid from cultural control, as we move up to mechanical controls. And mechanical controls are simply controls that cause the physical removal of varroa from the hive. And I can give you about four examples of these. The first example actually has removal in the name. That's drone brood removal, and that's a really simple method that you can use. You can actually purchase sheets of foundation that are the size of drone cells, put those in frames, and put those frames in the hives. The bees will build the comb. Because these cells are large, the queen will lay unfertilized eggs in them, and it will result in the production of drone brood. And we know varroa are preferentially attracted to drone brood. So when you have a comb of drone brood in the nest, varroa will prefer to go to it. And once it's all capped, you can take that frame out, put it in a freezer for 24 to 48 hours. That kills the developing drones as well as the varroa. And put that frame back into the hive. The bees will uncap those cells. They'll remove the developing drones that are dead. They'll remove the dead varroa, and the cycle will start all over again with the queen laying eggs. You'll get drone brood, varroa will go to it, and you just keep this rotation of drone brood combs going in and out of the hive, thereby removing from that nest mechanically varroa that are infesting the drone. A second way that you can physically remove varroa from the nest is via the use of screened bottom boards. Now remember, historically, hives sit on solid bottom boards, so solid pieces of wood that when up against the brood box leave that gap in the front through which bees can come and go. Well, if that solid bottom board is replaced by a screen bottom board, research has shown that you'll have about a 14% lower varroa population in the nest. What does that mean? Well, if you've got that screen bottom board on the bottom of the hive, as bees groom themselves, if varroa come out of cells, they will periodically fall through that bottom board in the hive and never be able to get back into the nest. But just using screen bottom boards, you can reduce varroa populations in the nest. Another way to potentially remove varroa from that colony, or at least from the budding colony, is when you purchase packages of bees, you can do things to the bees in the package to remove those varroa so that when you put those bees into a brand new hive, you've got very few varroa going into that hive with them. And the best way to do that currently is through the use of powdered sugar. So I need to throw out this caveat. A lot of beekeepers believe that they can control varroa through dusting hives with powdered sugar. Multiple research projects have shown that does not work. So I am not suggesting to you to put powdered sugar into your open hives in an effort to reduce varroa populations. Instead, I am telling you, while bees are in packages, dusting those bees with powdered sugar does reduce the number of varroa on those bees, and thereby the number of varroa going with the bees into the hive when you hive that package. Now, the last mechanical control that I will tell you about is hyperthermia. Hyper, so higher thermia temperatures. There's been some research to suggest that higher temperatures in hives can actually reduce varroa survival and reproduction. So there are many contraptions that you can purchase and put onto hives that raise the temperature of that nest and thereby reduces varroa population. I will warn you, the science on this is still in its infancy. There's a lot of products out there that boast efficacy. I would always say that if you want to go that route, you need to see data before you pull that trigger, before you take that step. But I am just saying that hypothermia might be an option, and it certainly may be a growing option well into the future. Going up the treatment period, you go from mechanical to biological control. And biological control is really the easiest control to understand. Biological control is life control. Everything that's alive has something that wants to eat it or make it sick. So the key is you have to find that thing that wants to eat it, or find that thing that wants to make it sick, rear that thing up, and release it into the hive environment and trust that it will make varroa sick or eat varroa. There's been a fair amount of research on biological control that has led to some interesting application, but nothing really yet that's ready to use in hives. Hopefully that will change in the future, but they include things like entomopathogenic fungi, so a fungus that likes to consume varroa or make varroa sick, as it were. People have looked at pseudoscorpions and other things. The way biological control works best is for scientists to go to areas where the pest, in this case varroa, is native, find something that makes it sick in its native range, and then bring it back to its introduced range. Unfortunately, biological control hasn't worked great, but we haven't thrown in our hat just yet. We're hopeful that people someday will be able to find good biological control options for varroa. So rethinking this pyramid, we've got prevention before you step onto the pyramid, cultural control, which includes some genetics and breeding, mechanical control, and biological control. And then of course at the top of the pyramid, we have chemical control, but I'm going to describe that option for you in another video. So if you're using prevention, cultural control, and mechanical control appropriately, you keep those varroa populations low long so that you won't have to use chemical control so often, or when you do, its efficacy will be increased. So how might all of this integrate? I keep using the word IPM, that stands for integrated pest management. I use the phrase integrated pest management all the time. What does it mean to integrate? Well, think back at prevention, cultural, mechanical. Again, I hesitate to move into biological control because we don't have good options at the moment. But from a prevention standpoint, swarm control, robbing and drifting control, movement control. From a cultural control, I'm always recommending the use of resistant stock. You should not purchase unselected bees and queens. The selected bees and queens are out there available for use and they confer varroa resistance. So start there. Also, use screen bottom boards if you're in an environment that's conducive to it. You have to have a bottom on every hive anyway. So why not choose the one that reduces varroa populations currently? If you're a hobbyist beekeeper, drone brood removal or brood cessation, causing the hive to stop brood production, those might be good options for you to integrate with some of these other things. So using multiple non-chemical control options simultaneously to reduce those varroa numbers in your hives will go a long way to helping you control varroa and certainly hopefully offset the number of times you need to step in and control varroa chemically.